which channel for the... Nancy, I can print some more in a second. Nancy.
Yeah. Good morning. Welcome to all of you here in the sanctuary and those of you joining us virtually. John Murphy, serving as your worship associate today. My pronouns are he, his. Together with Sarah Cannon, Director of Children's and Community Programming, our speaker, Crystal Francis, and our summer pastoral care intern, not intern anymore, minister. Got to get these titles right. Their pronouns are she, her, and Elizabeth Valencia, her pronouns are she, ella, E-L-L-A, ella. We thank you for joining us this morning. We invite you to bring your whole self with us in worship today. In a few moments, we'll open our service with reading of the covenant and chalice lighting. These rituals remind us to continually renew our promise to live into our covenant, to put love into action, and to live out the community of love and justice we aim to be. We are really delighted to have one of our members at All Souls, Crystal Francis, to speak to us today, and her subject will be change, and she's going to talk about a few of her ideas concerning change. When we light the chalice, if you feel like it at home, feel free to light your own chalice and say our covenant if you like. For those of you here in the sanctuary and those of you online, if you have something you need for us to know, I would invite you to fill out a connection card. Drop it here, drop it in the collection plate, online, fill it out and submit it. This card will help us understand what you might need to help support you and to keep connected. Let us worship together.
Come in from the summer heat. Come in from the threat of a summer storm. Find refuge during our time this morning in the spirit of love that is All Souls. Know that you are welcome to share your spirit here in this moment and with those gathered here. Whether you are in search of cool shade, whether you are in search of respite, whether you need inspiration or a kind smile, come in from the summer heat.
Thank you. Before we have our chalice lighting, I've been asked to mention a couple of things that are going on at our church, and I just forgot. I apologize that these were handed to me at the last minute. Reverend Katie would like to invite you to join her in a 5K run walk September 17th, okay? It's going to begin at the Arsenal Tech High School. So if you're interested in joining her, put that date on your calendar and join. It's on September 17th. It's a 5K run walk, and it will begin at Arsenal Tech High School. Also, we'd like to mention that our adult forum, which we've had sporadically on and off on the 24th, we'd like for you to join us if you can make it for a discussion about incarceration. And speaker is Grace Mitchell, and she will help lead us a discussion about that. So keep those announcements in mind.
Good morning. This morning I have a beautiful call to worship by Jules Jaramillo titled The Hearts of Our Whole Community. And it will invite us to take some breaths together. If you feel comfortable to participate as a community, I invite you. This morning, we gather together to worship as a community of all ages. Let us take a moment to look around at those of us sharing the sacred space. Let us recognize the hearts of our whole community, from our elders to our youngest, and all the ages in between. And let us embody the beauty of this whole church community, even when there are a few more wiggles and giggles and chatter. Let us remind ourselves to listen carefully, calming our bodies and our minds. Begin by breathing peace and joy into this sacred place with 3 breaths. And know that you are surrounded by the love of this community, where all are welcome. Let us worship together this morning.
Please join us this morning as Lily Kennedy lights our chalice in reciting the words of our covenant, which is on the wall behind us. Love is the spirit of this church, and service is its law, to dwell together in peace, to seek the truth in love, and to help one another. This is our covenant.
Thank you, Nazarene. Today, Crystal Francis, as I mentioned, she's going to talk about how to encourage change, both individually and globally. Although we do accept that change is inevitable, it seems to me that in much of our lives, we see it play out in a kind of a back and forth sort of way. Sometimes I think it's even hard to determine whether we are witnessing permanent change, or just a passing fad. This problem is apparent, especially apparent in my wardrobe. You know, I have a variety of neckties in my closet, narrow, medium, wide. My dubious theory is that I will always be in style, even though they change back and forth. You know, I think this idea of ebb and flow is present in our language. You hear some things like saying, what goes around comes around. The more things change, the more they stay the same. There's nothing new under the sun. In my professional career, I saw firsthand, in the face of some new approach or idea by management, there was often a belief, well-grounded belief, I would say, amongst my colleagues, if they just hunkered down for a while, the inertia of the system would prevail and things would return to normal. I think you may have seen that in your careers as well. With regard to changes in our society and the world around us, I see a constant tug of war between those who embrace moving forward and those who want to return to how it used to be. Again, back and forth. I think it's good to have a healthy tension between those two polar opposites. But here's the thing. It never was and never will be possible to revert completely back. So for me, it's a useless waste of time and energy in nostalgia for the good old days. They were never that good anyway. So presently in our congregation, we're approaching a time when our new minister, Reverend Katie, will join us. Changes are coming. From what I can determine, she'll likely challenge us to try some new things, some of which may make us a bit nervous, apprehensive, even uncomfortable. It'll be interesting to see how we react to that situation. For me, I plan to personally cope with this possibility by remembering this, that while some of the trappings in the way we do church may change, maybe back and forth, possibly, our core principles and purpose will remain an anchor that I can hang on to. And unlike the neckties in my closet, I would say some things in our church, in our UU faith, will never go out of style. I'm going to bank on it.
I'm so happy to be here, and this is a very important time for all ages, so I'm ready to get into it, y'all. So all summer long in our faith formation programs, and we've spilled over into the time for all ages, we've been talking about covenants, how they are alive, and how they change as we learn what works for our community. But today, I want to talk a little bit about right relationship. And that's maybe a new term for some of us, right relationship. And this is how we describe what we do to stay in covenant, our actions and also our attitudes. And that's important stuff to know because, as Crystal's gonna point out today, there are healthy ways to be together in our communities, and then sometimes there are harmful ways. As Unitarians, we believe that everyone cares about and is curious about and is thinking about what's going on in our community, and that their ideas matter. As Universalists, we believe that everyone is beloved by our higher power, if we believe in a higher power, and we simply believe that human beings are essentially good. So, people care, people are good. Those are the basics, our foundation, as we go into every situation. And sometimes we say it this way: assume best intentions. Now, if you approach things in this way, you will be surprised how many problems that could get bigger don't. A lot of the times, the reason we struggle to solve a problem is because we're treating the other person like they are the problem. And usually that's not true. It's just that we each have different pieces of the puzzle and we're frustrated. Human beings get frustrated. But here at All Souls, we are a faith community. And the number one thing Unitarian Universalists share faith in is each other. So we lead with that when there's a problem. That's our core spiritual practice. Now, it's really important to know what it looks like when you or somebody else is not in right relationship. It's important to be able to name it, and it's important to have the skills to deal with it. So, here are some things to watch out for. First, sometimes our friends come to us to complain about somebody else or to ask us for advice. Give me a sign if that's ever happened to you. Right, for sure. It's happened to all of us, right? And sometimes that's all they need, and by the end of the conversation, they've either figured out what they need to do or they've decided, it wasn't such a big deal after all. But other times that doesn't happen. It's a problem that needs a solution. And at those times, it's really important to stay focused on solving it like a UU. We believe that the person they're complaining about or having a problem with cares and is good. So they have to have a chance to know there's a problem and help solve it. So we ask a very important question, wait for it. Have you talked to the person you're talking about? And if the answer is no, there are some other things we can say. Like, I think it would be good if you do talk to the person. Are you nervous to talk to the person? Why? Do you need help or support to talk to the person? Now, that last one is especially important if the two people have different levels of power, like maybe a kid and a grown-up, or someone who's having a conflict with a person who's in a leadership role above them, or maybe someone who is part of a group that is often treated unfairly, like disabled people, or people of color, or LGBTQIA people. If the person needs some help, we can either help them ourselves, or we can connect them with someone else in the church who knows how to support them. And then we set limits about whether we're gonna listen to the complaining anymore. Because sometimes it's easier to complain than to do the covenantal thing. And after a person complains, they'll feel better, but that feeling is temporary. They'll be back. Because complaining does not usually solve the problem all by itself. So, as UUs, we believe in solving that problem together. That's literally why we're here, because we wanted to solve the problem of people fighting over theology. Being UU means moving toward solutions. Now, all of this has been really basic, right, relationship stuff. This is the ABCs of being in community together. Because, again, give me a sign if you've ever complained about something before. Yeah, I should put both hands up for sure. Yeah, like it happens, we're human. And we all struggle sometimes with remembering to talk to the person we're talking about. But also, some of us have learned unhealthy patterns that are bigger problems. And, you know, some of us know that and we're working on it, and some of us don't know it and we're not working on it yet. And this is where our community has to do the big capital W work of right relationship, because an unhealthy pattern can infect a community just like COVID. And right relationship is the vaccine. So, here are some important pattern problems to watch out for. And this is maybe the most important thing we'll talk about this year. Not kidding. So if a person tells you something like it's a big secret, and then you start to realize that they're actually telling kind of a lot of people, that's one example. If the way they tell it is very different from the way that you actually saw it happen with your own eyes, or you can't find any proof that it happened at all, that's another one. If these kind of conflicts seem to happen to this particular person like a lot, if a person's really interested in problems, but not very interested in solutions. If a person tends to freak out very loudly about kind of small problems. If a person has a list of groups or people who are out to get them, and they like to tell mean stories about those people. These are all pattern problems. And pattern problems can be unlearned. But not everyone is ready to unlearn a pattern problem right now. But just like we believe that everyone cares and is good, we expect everyone to use the skills a caring, good person would use. And if they don't know them yet, that's fine. But we expect them to show that they care and are good by actively learning those skills. So you, all of you, have to be very good at noticing pattern problem behavior. Because if someone is in right relationship, they're going to talk to the person. But if it's a pattern problem person, they're going to talk about that person to all of you. And if you don't realize that's what's going on, that means that the first person can be living by our covenant right now and still be very unsafe in our community. We are the only ones who can fix that. Times of change, like doing more programs in the building, or moving up to a different age group in faith formation, or having a new renter or a new minister, these are often times when we're nervous, we're stretching in uncomfortable directions, we're experiencing change and feeling a little bit grumpy about it. And it's okay to be grumpy. And I'm a hugger, by the way, if that helps. But it's also when harm happens, if we don't have the skills to stay in right relationship ourselves and support our All Souls friends and neighbors in doing it too, the way our UU faith calls us to do. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. We share joys and sorrows each Sunday as part of our spiritual practice of community and our covenant to live by the Spirit of love. A reminder that if you have a joy or sorrow to share with the congregation, please reach out to Shelley at office@allsoulsindy.org. In our All Souls community this week, Allison Cole is spending the next 2 weeks in Durham, North Carolina, caring for her mother, who is recovering from an infection in a rehab facility. We wish your mom, Allison, a full recovery, and we are holding you and your family in our hearts. We hold in our hearts Rex and Lynn Martin, who were dealing with COVID. I haven't had an update since receiving the news. We wish you good health, and others who are currently dealing with COVID as well as there are others or who are dealing with illness as well. It's a scary time when the symptoms have become a bit blurred and we all kind of get into that panic. And gratitude again this morning to our worship planning team that is supporting you through this summer. And thank you to the staff team and thank you to the board. All of these people together are making sure that July is busy and active and that we're present for you. And wow, we get to welcome and finally host the children and the families and the staff of the East Coast Migrant Head Start Project, the Indianapolis campus. There's gonna be more information. Right now you have some information in your order of service, someone out in the know. You'll be getting some more information. They will not begin on Monday. There's still a few things in the building we gotta get ready. So they will communicate with us exactly what day they are launching, but they are launching and we are excited. So thank you All Souls for welcoming and for hosting the Indianapolis campus. This is going to be amazing work for our community. Thank you. And with that, there's important safety protocols, right? And some of that is making sure that the doors don't stay propped, right? So anybody who's coming into the church building, making sure all doors stay closed when you come in, and that we don't go downstairs. Those who are interested in volunteering will have the opportunity to get in contact with Bati when that time is here, and she will communicate exactly, you know, the procedures for going downstairs, but no going downstairs from the atrium, and making sure that we keep the kids as safe as we can, and thank you. And then in our world at large, this month of July is BIPOC Mental Health Month. BIPOC, again, stands for Black Indigenous People of Color. Creating a mental health month for our BIPOC communities intends to name the unique struggles of our BIPOC people. As we continue to see the aftermath of the ongoing racism in our country, as we continue to acknowledge how much more harmful the overturning of Roe v. Wade is going to be for BIPOC women, pregnant people, BIPOC faith groups, families, and communities at large, it's important and necessary to tie in mental health. And this ties in with how important it is right now with the national release of the 988 mental health hotline that's now live. And I'm sure there's gonna be some things they gotta fix and we gotta fix as a state. But this new line will help fill in the gaps to connect people needing mental health support to trained mental health advocates. This is going to be the 911 for mental health. So this will be the 988. So this will connect people in crisis to help immediately, and it will help bypass that interaction with law enforcement that we know law enforcement is not trained in mental health. In fact, law enforcement isn't even required to see therapists to work through their stuff. I want to let you know, as somebody who's a therapist intern right now, we have to see a therapist weekly when we work with clients. Police don't have to see therapists. So there's a lot of great ways that 988 is going to help bridge the gaps. And so we hold in our hearts all of us and all of those who have hope in this system that we're adding this 988 as we hope again towards justice, a community of care and presence and love. May it be successful and may we figure out the little gaps as we go. And finally, our Indiana legislature is holding a special session on July 25th. Our community is doing work around making sure the voices of all are heard for this session, where we know they are going to bring in the topic of abortion. There's an open letter that faith and lay leaders are being asked to sign from a multi-faith coalition for reproductive choice. We need to remember that our faith has voted in an action of intentional witness, where we are being called to act and make a personal commitment to this work, to educate ourselves and reflect on our personal connections to reproductive health, rights, justice, reflecting on our own values, such as freedom and privacy, consistent for all, and how to act in accountable, sustainable ways. This is our first step. And of course, to organize ourselves. It will be important work ahead of us to organize ourselves here at All Souls and across faiths and with other faiths, as this is a major issue of religious freedom for all. So we will be able to, can already be doing advocacy by letters to the editor, letters and visits to legislators, holding all accountable is important across parties. This will be an ongoing conversation in our spaces. So we hold all of you in our hearts, and we hold all of this in our hearts this morning. And there's always more. There's always more to say on Sundays. This morning I have a meditation that Crystal Francis shared with me. It's called Fierce Urgency by Ashley Horn. My 4-year-old daughter has taught me this lesson. When a child wants to derail business as usual to curb adults who dare believe in schedules and plans and productivity, one fierce little body and one clear, piercing voice, strategically applied to the right pressure point, will change the course of the day's events. My comrades in organizing have taught me this lesson, that when a silenced people want to be heard, to raise from dry bones a living, breathing dream of new ways of moving, being, incarnating freedom, one small, tenacious group whose hearts beat in rhythm, rising shoulder to shoulder against the inevitable, will bend the arc from impossibility to hope. Our young climate leaders are teaching us this lesson, when the grown-ups and the old movements are too slow, as the sea levels rise and the hurricanes rage and the migrants flee and the corporations profit, one generation, both young and silenced, refusing to accept an inheritance of doom, will take towards the streets and move us towards life. Blessings upon them as they teach us, organize us, beckon us in, and call us out. May their fierce urgency and uncompromising clarity show us the path toward healing and freedom and hope. Blessed be, Ashe, and Amen.
This morning, half of our offertory will go to the American Civil Liberties Union of Indiana. Your contributions today will help support the important work of this organization. The ACLU was founded in 1920, but the Indiana chapter was founded in 1953 with the intense involvement and help from All Souls. I don't know if all of you knew that, but All Souls was very instrumental in establishing what was then the ICLU, now it's known as the ACLU of Indiana. In any case, this organization, as you know, has as its purpose to protect the rights of individuals that are guaranteed by the Constitution, U.S. Constitution, Indiana Constitution, and court decisions. Last week, actually, we had Ken Falk from the ACLU in our pulpit to talk about how it's important to respect the rights of everyone and tell us about that organization. So, to contribute, you can put cash or check in the collection basket as it's passed around. If you go with us online, there's a link provided on the website that says Give to All Souls, which you can use to make your contribution. Thank you for your generosity in supporting the mission of All Souls and for supporting this important organization. So the morning offering will now be given and accepted. Thank you.
Change is inevitable. No matter how hard we resist it, it just keeps coming at us. Whether it is the natural passage of time bringing change or the explosion of new ideas, change is always there. My husband Dennis and I have been married for 27 years. Life is different than it was in 1995 when we married. We have raised a family. We have seen the aging and eventual death of our parents. Our hairs are grayer than when we started. Various presidents have come and gone. We have survived consumer debt and illness. Change can take the form of a global change, like climate change. Or it can be a personal change, like deciding to stop buying pop at the grocery store. Sometimes change encompasses both the personal and the global. Naturally, some resistance may be met with either type of change. I'm more likely to embrace changes at home than Dennis, who has his own collection of ties, John. He likes the comfort and reliability of knowing that the furniture in the living room is going to stay in the same spot day after day, month after month, year after year, in his dreams. I'm more of the type that likes to keep tweaking furniture arrangement just to satisfy the need for change or to find a better arrangement than has thus far been tried. Occasionally, piece joins the arrangement or leaves. Sometimes I flip things around to accommodate a party or a Christmas tree. Life has not been all change, but even the steady constants have required some adjustment. Even when life here has seemed pretty good, there's nothing like watching the national news or viewing social media to learn that life is not so good in other places around the world, like in Ukraine. There are a remarkable number of things that I would change in the world if I could be queen for a day and had the power to change whatever I wanted. Wouldn't that be great? I think it would. I'm not sure that one day would be enough. Plus, I doubt very much that a change I make as a sole individual would stay in place once it was someone else's turn to be queen or king. Global change is just not that simple or permanent. The UU's sixth principle is the goal of a world community with peace, liberty, and justice for all. Sounds good, huh? It is an aspirational goal, something that we hope for and strive to reach. An aspirational goal has the touch of the impossible to it, as if it were out of reach. Being an aspirational goal does not let us off the hook to do our best to change the world. I do believe that change is possible, but I think it requires several of us working together to make it happen. So, how do we accomplish change? Short of becoming queen for a day? Well, we must recognize a problem that we can agree is a problem. This can be harder than it seems, but there are plenty of things that most of us could agree upon. Hunger, injustice, and homelessness are just a few of those things. We must understand the harm caused by the problem and the need for change. Most of us would agree as to the problem of hunger and how hunger causes death in the most vulnerable populations, like children. We then need to convince others to make the change needed to solve the problem. This change might be viewed as a personal or communal sacrifice necessary to solve the problem. It might mean sharing our food or changing the way we eat to allow more grain to reach those who are starving. Persuading people to change is perhaps the hardest part of the problem. The comfortable people who are well-fed have little reason, in the absence of personal pain or empathy, to change. persuasion can take several different methods. Having spent part of my life as a negotiator, I have thought about different methods. I'm going to cover six of these particular methods. Force, bribery, coercion, shame, trade, and by example. Force. Change by force is not a method I'm advocating, but it is hard to deny that force is persuasive. Violence or the threat of violence is a powerful incentive for change. Sometimes it is the only way people think that their voices will be heard. For example, take a look at a nursery school room of two-year-olds. Because they haven't yet learned their words, they use their teeth to communicate their biting points. Bribery. Bribery is a time-honored method. Now, don't look at me like that, please. Sure, bribery has a negative reputation, but it should not be overlooked as a peaceful means to persuade someone, like a crying child, a grumpy coworker, or the family pet. American foreign policy often uses bribery in the form of incentives to persuade countries to behave in accordance with our goals. Bribery can corrupt a government or individuals, so it should be used sparingly. But when used judiciously, bribery works nicely. Well, for as long as the money lasts. Coercion. Coercion is less playful than bribery. Truth be known, it carries some criminal connotations. If bribery is a carrot, coercion is a stick. The threat of a sanction or punishment can be a powerful persuader. It is a leverage that forces the other side to toe the line, or else. Coercion might take the form of a threat of violence, but it also can be a threat of economic sanctions or blackmail. It could be a threat of exclusion. Do what I want or I won't play with you anymore. Do your homework or I'll take away your cell phone. I've thought about this other one quite a bit. Shame. Parents are often stereotyped as persuaders by shame or guilt. This can be fairly subtle, not always, but we all recognize it when it happens to us. My mother could turn my innocent question about what she would like for her birthday into a form of torture. Guilt frequently works, especially against the conscientious person. I was never sure there was a right answer or behavior. The underlying message seemed to be, if I was a good daughter, I would simply know the right answer. Now, my dad was more of a force or coercion kind of guy. As a result, he was easier to make happy because it was clear what he wanted, because he told me. Sometimes the shaming comes in the form of name calling. You know, we see just how plain mean this can be at work, at school, or on social media when the name calling starts. Once one person starts it, it is difficult to control how quickly others start to do it. It is hurtful to watch. The consequences of failing political correctness is often the shame imposed by society. Shame may include being publicly shunned. Most of us would avoid the shame and guilt of public opinion, if possible, with tearful apologies and promises of better behavior. Now let's turn to some methods that are less intimidating. Trade. Close in form to bribery is trade, essentially buying change. It is perhaps more balanced than bribery. It allows both sides to scratch each other's back in a win-win deal. Of course, both sides need to have something to exchange and a willingness to make the deal. Then we come to the most honorable means of persuasion, by example. This is a strategy that I recommend for our purposes today. If only it were universally effective to persuade by example. People who are good examples of desired behavior can persuade others to change by their examples. But these folks often go unnoticed outside their own circle of family and friends. We have some excellent examples here at All Souls of unsung people who work for positive change in the world. We recognize the unsung heroes and heroines among us. At least I hope we do. Of course, there are sometimes a scarcity of good examples with enough far-reaching influence to make broad change. Real superheroes are hard to find. Even the ones in movies seem to have flaws, often using violence as the primary means to an end, which is not a morally acceptable method of change for UUs and the sixth principle. Still, it is helpful to see a true hero whom we all can admire and copy. Mahatma Gandhi, Mother Teresa, Martin Luther King Jr., former President Jimmy Carter and Rosalind Carter. They all stand out as good examples for all of us in their efforts to make the world a better place. Morally, persuasion by example is the high ground. It is hard to accomplish without sounding self-righteous. Good behavior often goes unnoticed. Even those who admire the good behavior may not be persuaded to change their own behavior. Perhaps more than any other method of persuasion, by example suggests a commitment and loyalty not otherwise seen. When by example works, it carries additional strength because this commitment and loyalty endure. My grandfather was named after our first president. By any chance, does anyone know who the first president of the United States was? Excellent. Excellent, thank you. George Washington Francis, my grandfather, was born 100 years after the president died, keeping the name of honor alive 5 generations later. Nearly 100 years more, my son carries the middle name George as a remembrance. Leaving aside the methods of change to achieve change in a world for a moment, let's think about making change in the individual person. Change for me is almost always a process that occurs over time. It takes me a while to go through the steps to recognize the need for change and then to understand what kind of change I need. Harder still can be the steps to reach the change. It can take a lot of self-discipline to make a permanent change. Those good habits my parents instilled in me as a child have been excellent ways to help me grow. Of course, not all my habits are good. There are maybe more than several, which would benefit from a change. New habits require time and consistent practice to develop. Plus, I need to really buy into the reason for the change. For instance, when my doctor suggested that I stop drinking caffeine, or at least limit my caffeine intake due to pregnancy, I made a sincere effort to do so, even if I was not entirely successful. Growing a baby turned out to be an excellent motivator. As hard as an individual change is, community change can be more difficult to accomplish. Multiply the effort to achieve individual change by a congregation, a city, a state, or a nation, and you understand why community change requires so much effort. Social media has been helpful in some ways to promote change, but like everything else, it gives voices to those who are resistant to the change too. There are those who are content, if not absolutely happy, with the status quo. And unfortunately, there are those who favor change, just not the change I would like to see if I were queen. Try deciding as a group on a color to paint a building or a room, And you understand my point. There is no denying that some change is painful, even in the face of a desirable benefit. During COVID lockdown, it was wonderful how quiet and peaceful it seemed without traffic filling the streets. I did not drive or leave the house for weeks at a time, but I did enjoy the quiet. Some of us, perhaps not all of us, are willing to sacrifice if we value the benefit enough. If the value received is understood to be greater than the cost of the sacrifice, some of us will choose to make the sacrifice. We pay for recycling pickup at our house because we value recycling. The sacrifice seems small. Better yet would be not to buy anything made of plastic. All I can say is that we try at our house. Some of us will still resist a personal sacrifice if the benefit is not directly related to us, or if it is so distant in time as to not be perceived as a benefit to us. Give up gasoline-driven cars? That is a large sacrifice, even knowing that climate change is strongly affected by the emissions from gasoline engines. If I knew that my unborn great-grandchild would be unable to play outside due to climate change, would that persuade me? Could I make a change now? I hope so. I think so. What would you give up for reduced climate change? Would you agree to a personal sacrifice? Many of us already make sacrifices and choices to reduce climate change. We recycle our paper, cardboard, plastics, and glass. The effort is really a good habit. We aim to buy fuel-efficient cars, including electric and hybrid cars, when we replace a vehicle. We compost our food scraps in exchange for better gardening soil. We turn our yards into native meadows to promote honeybees and other wildlife. We walk, bike, and carpool as we can to preserve the air. Of course, to convince us of the need to sacrifice to reduce climate change, we must accept the harmful reality of the problem. We must understand that the cause of climate change is connected to our own use of fossil fuels and that our sacrifices will help solve the problem. Promoting good information is essential in a world where misinformation is increasingly accepted as justification for ignoring the need to change how we live. I can speak to the harm that climate change has on the air we breathe because I'm very sensitive to the air quality around me. You've seen me with my portable oxygen concentrator that helps provide needed oxygen. This is especially important to me on high temperature days with high humidity, or days when there's smoke or lots of particulates in the air. There are days when it's dangerous for me and people like me with breathing issues to be outside right now. We must also value a future for our children which is threatened by climate change. We must see the problem as our problem, as an inevitable problem, not just a possible future problem that is not our responsibility. All Souls has been a good community example. We've installed solar panels to ease our reliance upon fossil fuels used by our public utilities. We recycle our trash. We provide recycling services for our neighbors. We've planted trees to improve the air quality and reduce ozone. We have an environmental group that continues to work on ideas to help our community. There are lots of ways to help make a positive change in our community, not just for the cause of climate change. We know too well that there are other problems that require change in our collective behavior. Before we convince others to make a community change, we have to be willing to change ourselves. I invite you to think about the changes you are willing to make and to share those changes with the rest of the congregation. We can make a difference. Even just as one person, and more so as a congregation through shared ideas. Do not ever think that we cannot create change or that it is hopeless to try. Change is not only possible, it is necessary to our survival. Consider anthropologist Margaret Mead's statement, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has." Thank you. Thanks. Now, please rise in body or spirit as you're able to sing hymn 1017 in the Green Hymnal. Spirit of all blessing, be with us in the ordinariness of our days. May hope's light guard us and keep cynicism from our hearts. May the energy of laughter build endurance for the dark times of our lives. May creativity's vision grant the possibility of seeing old relationships with new eyes. May the oil of healing keep us from anger's hardness and despair. May the mantle of humility give us courage to admit when we are wrong. May compassion's loom weave in us the discipline to forgive. May patience help us to bear in mind that ours is not the only scale of time. May the flame of justice be a beacon for the choices we must make. May peace be ever in us and sustain our stressful days. Spirit of all blessing, be with us in the ordinariness of our days. Go in peace.
Change for once in my life.
It's gonna feel real good. Gonna make a difference. Gonna make it right. As I turn up the collarboard, my favorite winter coat, this wind is blowing my mind. I see the kids in the street, but not enough to eat. Who am I to be blind?